Welcome to TIFFBell Lightbox, everyone. My name is Keith Benny. I'm the Senior Manager of Adult Learning here at TIFF. It's our pleasure to welcome you to our event this afternoon, our second event in our Trek Talk series here at TIFF, celebrating, of course, the 50th anniversary of Star Trek. Our special event today, Bridging Science and the Arts. A few thank yous before we get started. On behalf of TIFF, I'd like to thank our lead sponsor, Bell, our major sponsors, RBC, L'Oreal Paris, and Visa, as well as our major public supporters, the Government of Canada, the Government of Ontario, and the City of Toronto. We'd also like to thank our donors and members for supporting our year-round programming here at TIFF, making our charitable and outreach events possible. I would like to acknowledge the Mississaugas of New Credit, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat, the original keepers of this land, for hosting TIFF year-round. Our Trek Talk series is presented in partnership with CBS and the Canadian Space Agency. We'd like to extend a huge thank you to both of these organizations for partnering with us on these events and making our Trek Talks a reality. We'd like to welcome all of you here with us in the cinema. Thank you for coming here today. And I'd like to extend another welcome to our online audiences joining us via the live stream at YouTube and Facebook Live. We are plugged in, ready to go, beaming this out. So welcome, everyone. For those of you here with us in the cinema, I ask you please place your phones on silent. No photo or video recording is permitted, but we do, of course, have professional cameras capturing the event here today. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions of our guests, so think of your questions as the event proceeds, and we'll just ask that you wait for a microphone to reach you before asking your question. Okay, that is all the data I needed to impart to you before we move forward on our mission, so let's get a little further into it. Writer and producer Gene Roddenberry and his collaborators conceived of a future with enhanced technologies, progressive values, and a more tolerant social structure that was an aspirational and hopeful vision of the future. And so that's our starting point for Trek Talks, which features discussions and presentations that consider the influence, the 50-year legacy of Star Trek on our culture. So it's now my distinct pleasure to welcome some of our experts today who will unpack some of these questions for us. Marion Mader is Managing Director at the Royal Ontario Museum and the co-founder of STEAM Lab's Community Makerspace. She has studied some of the oldest rocks on Earth in Greenland. She's explored the impact craters across the globe and collected meteorites in Antarctica. Mader has collaborated with the Canadian Space Agency, NASA, and Canadian space companies to plan and execute simulated planetary missions. Please join me in welcoming Marion Mader. Jeremy Hansen is a modern-day explorer. He began flying at the age of 17, eventually becoming a CF-18 fighter pilot. In 2009, Jeremy was selected from a pool of over 5,000 candidates to become one of two Canadian astronauts. Since then, his intensive astronaut training has included geological expeditions to the high Arctic, exploring alien caves, and conducting scientific experiments in weightlessness. Please join me in welcoming Jeremy Hansen. Sunny Coley is a physician and adjunct faculty member at McMaster University. As an alumnus of the International Space University and former CSA astronaut candidate, he became intrigued by science age solutions to the world's health problems. He co-founded CloudDX to create a fully autonomous digital doctor called Vitality, which is currently a finalist in the Qualcomm Tricorder X Prize competition. Please join me in welcoming Sunny Coley. So thank you all for being here today. Getting a little further into our mission so you know what we'll be speaking about this afternoon. Today's panel considers the way in which Star Trek has had an immense educational impact on science, technology, engineering, and the arts. Now this is obviously a big question, 50 years of Star Trek trying to understand its legacy. And so to be specific, here are the four areas that we've kind of identified today that we're gonna unpack and explore for you. One, how Star Trek communicates scientific principles, theories, and concepts to a mass audience. Two, how it has inspired the public's interest in science engagement and technological advance and the exploration of our universe. Three, how it inspired individuals to pursue careers in science, to create new technologies and undertake research. And four, since Star Trek is probably one of the most fitting examples, the vital relationship between science and the arts, how science can inspire the arts and how the arts can inspire science. And so to start, we're not gonna let these individual speak just yet. We're going to kick things off with a bit of a montage of scenes from the show, which consider some of the ways in which Star Trek bridges science and the arts, which we'll consider a little further with our panelists. So to start, let's take a look.
Mr. Data, could this be a Dyson sphere?
The object does fit the general parameters of Dyson's theory.
A Dyson sphere? It's a very old theory, number one. I'm not surprised that you haven't heard of it. In the 20th century, a physicist called Freeman Dyson postulated the theory that an enormous hollow sphere could be constructed around a star. This would have the advantage of harnessing all the radiant energy of that star, and any population living on the interior surface would have virtually inexhaustible sources of power.
Report. Captain, there are no stars outside.
Well, that's partially accurate. Actually, there's no universe outside.
On screen. Commander?
I'm showing a large buildup of baryonic particles.
Perfectly normal.
Captain, based on our readings, it appears we've been transported back in time to the birth of the universe.
Very old hiding place.
Now, I know all the hiding places, Q. I hid here from the continuum myself once.
This ship will not survive the formation of the cosmos.
It's only a tricorder. See? It won't hurt you. Now try it.
Well done, Mr. Neelix.
Tell me, did your visit to the Cerulean ship involve any, romance?
What?
Were you intimate with anyone?
Doc, I was over there to repair a warp reactor. What are you talking about?
Seems you did a little more than repair work.
Meaning?
This is a nipple.
I beg your pardon?
The blastocyst is located between the 6th and 7th intercostals.
What the hell are you talking about?
I'm not quite sure if congratulations are in order, Commander, but you're pregnant.
I plan to study the performances of Olivier, Branagh, Shapiro, and Kulnark.
Data, you're here to learn about the human condition, and there is no better way of doing that than by embracing Shakespeare. But you must discover it through your own performance, not by imitating others.
What are you doing?
I am painting.
I can see that. How long have you been at this?
I have created 23 individual illustrations in the past 6 hours, 27 minutes. I believe you could say I have been inspired.
They used to say if a man could fly, he'd have wings. But he did fly. He discovered he had to. Do you wish that the first Apollo mission hadn't reached the moon? Or that we hadn't gone on to Mars and then to the nearest star? That's like saying you wish that you still operated with scalpels and sewed your patients up with catgut, like your great-great-great-great-grandfather used to. I'm in command. I could order this. But I'm not. Because Dr. McCoy is right in pointing out the enormous danger potential in any contact with life and intelligence as fantastically advanced as this. But I must point out that the possibilities, the potential for knowledge and advancement is equally great. Risk. Risk is our business. That's what this starship is all about. That's why we're aboard her. You may descend without prejudice. Do I hear a negative vote? Engineer, stand by to beam aboard three receptacles.
I don't know about you, but I'm convinced. So there's a lot in that clip, of course, scientific principles and theories, scenes about the medical tricorder, data's enthusiasm for the arts, and of course that impassioned plea for risk, exploration, and discovery. So to start, I'm curious about each of your first encounters with Star Trek. Which series did you originally watch, and what impression did it first have on you, its premise, its characters?
Great.
Just jump in, yeah.
Sure, I'll start. So I am definitely of the Star Trek Next Generation. And I actually had to look up the years that it ran, and it was basically from, for me anyway, the end of elementary school through to high school. So really formational years. And I guess we'll talk about that kind of depth of influence. But for me, I'm Next Gen through and through, and then watch some of the Voyager series after.
So, similar story for me. I definitely consumed probably all of The Next Generation in my high school years and was just completely taken by it. And it allowed me to, you know, imagine what it would be like to be a space explorer. But I thought it'd be neat to recount this story because I have this, you know, there are times in your life you have these very isolated memories from early on. And I remember being at my grandparents' house. I was an only child. And so I'd get bored at Grandpa's house because my parents would be visiting him, and sometimes there'd be nothing to do. And I remember being—I can see his living room. I was quite young; I was, you know, less than 10 for sure. And I remember I can see the living room, the TV, and I'm watching Star Trek, the original series there, and it's burned in my brain. So I must have liked it because I haven't forgotten it to this day.
We're drawing lines in the sand because I'm of the original Star Trek series. I'm of that vintage. I'm dating myself. Without question, I watch a bit of Next Generation. But the original Star Trek airing on CBC after school, growing up in Calgary, Alberta, is what was my inspiration. And for so many reasons. First of all, I was a kid, was visibly a minority. I wore a turban at the time. And I think I was the only kid with a turban in my part of Calgary. So I look like a Vulcan, like I look like an alien, and I was sometimes treated like an alien. And so it resonated with me because I was like, wow, there is a world, there's this aspirational universe where we can all just fit in and I can just be like everybody else. And that was inspirational to me. And also just a kid nerding out on Star Trek was just a lot of fun. So.
And Marianne, you have said that Star Trek was, you know, inspirational in you choosing your career path. And so what was it about watching Star Trek that inspired you to go into the sciences and to go into space exploration?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, I mean, for me, Star Trek, for anyone in this room, it's about exploration. And so I grew up in a family of six, four kids. And every summer we would pack up in a station wagon and go exploring. And so that was integral as part of my childhood. And so was Star Trek. And it kind of reinforced those values of exploration and the importance of it. It was a show that we watched as a family. I never questioned that something wouldn't be possible if I wanted to do it. And my family supported that, and academically people supported me along the way. But Star Trek kind of seeded that concept of exploration and going beyond what we know. So I went into a career of field geology, specializing in remote field sites. True exploration. So when we talk about science, there's different kinds of science, whether it's experimental, discovery-based science is doing things that you don't necessarily know what the answer will be. Mm-hmm. Maybe you don't even have a hypothesis going in. And so Star Trek really kind of showcases also that quality of science.
And Jeremy, for you, the mission of the Starship Enterprise, of course, is to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life, new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before. Did the mission resonate with you when you first started watching it? And how closely does the mission relate to what your work at the CSA seeks to accomplish?
Yeah, oh, for sure. It still resonates today. And even, you know, you hear those words and you're just like, yes, let's do that. Absolutely. Awesome. I mean, that's great. And, you know, When I was watching Star Trek, a little bit off your question, but when I was watching The Next Generation, I was going through a time in my life where I had goals and ambitions that I wasn't really prepared for, and I was aware of that. You know, I wanted to be in the Royal Canadian Air Force. I wanted to be a fighter pilot. I wanted to go on to be an astronaut. Air Cadets, I joined it to learn how to fly and start developing those skills, and it became very clear to me I was going to have to learn leadership. I was going to have to develop myself to be able to stand up in front of a group and be in charge, give commands on a parade square, teach lessons. And I was not comfortable with those things. I was pretty shy, reserved, quiet person. And it was obvious to me I needed to bring, you know, I needed to learn. And so I've always resonated with Picard, because for me, he just was a great leader, like true leadership skills. And representing the leadership skills I was learning about in society and air cadets, for example. And so that, I think, that was really helpful for me to see somebody embodying those and was a role model. Even though I've never met the human, I know the character, and I resonate with the character, so that is pretty neat. As far as the mission, of course, that is exactly what drives us. That's why we have that seed of exploration inside of us. We are constantly trying to get as far away from this planet as we can. Even though we love and appreciate it, we want to know what's out there, and we do want to explore strange new worlds. And we are looking, you know, it's not part of my day-to-day job looking for other life, but it's definitely one of our goals, that whenever we go somewhere, you know, Mars, we're looking for in the rock record for signs of life. Europa, we talked about it last night. Really hopeful we might find life there, and just imagine the impact that'll have on society. So it's definitely resonates with all of us, the people I work with.
And Sunny, we'll hear a bit about your attempts to bring the medical tricorder to reality. But as a physician, what medical advances and the whole kind of representation of medicine really speaks to you with the series?
Oh, it's to boldly go where no man has gone before. It resonates with me, because what McCoy was capable of doing, even though he's doing it very begrudgingly at times, it was just those capabilities. Like, I run an intensive care unit at my hospital, and so I'm dealing with critically ill people on life support, and the amount of machinery and infrastructure and the wires, and we make patients look like the Borg sometimes just to get them better, and yet he could do it seamlessly, and it seemed like you know, the whole concept of a zero interface. You don't even know that you're being probed and being examined and being treated. And that, to me, is the holy grail of medicine. And Star Trek was 50 years ahead of its time in exploring that concept. It really was inspirational for me.
And so 50 years on, like you say, the legacy continues. And why do you think it's been so successful, not only as science fiction, but also as a vision for the future? You know, you spoke about qualities of leadership. And so in addition to you know, science, but also providing us models of how to behave. Is there areas that you think that it did really well that has kind of continued the success of Star Trek?
Absolutely. I don't know if we'll keep going or if somebody wants to jump in. when I think about the legacy or the attraction of Star Trek, for me, it's the question of humanity. And the things that really resonate with me is why do we explore, you know, to explore the unknown? And also, what does it mean to be human? And when I think to, I mean, again, Next Gen, the storylines that I was really attracted to are ones that address that through Data or the Borg or interaction with new species or cultures. And that kind of change in perspective or self-reflection, it's in the context of science fiction, but that is something that's universal. And so I think that is why it's broadly appealing to many people who maybe even don't consider themselves to be science fiction enthusiasts?
For me, really two things. It's a follow-on to what I was saying about Picard and his leadership, but all through the series, it brings the best of humanity. I mean, it resonates with you because it's the way you know we want to be. Like, it represents our Canadian values, how we want to treat people, equality, seeing the value of every single human being on the planet. And that resonates with your soul, and I think that definitely contributes to its success. The other aspect that I think is really neat to ponder is the fact that I think most of us like the idea of new technologies, and we hear about something cool, and yeah, that's fascinating, but then you don't really get it until you can see how you would use it. And that's what Star Trek does. It shows you. Now, if I say, hey, it'd be really cool to take you to a space station, well, what do you see in your head? What do you imagine? How do you imagine it looking? I have to show you what it looks like. And then you can imagine yourself there. That's what Star Trek does. It shows you, hey, new technology, and this is how you'd use it. You'd make tea Earl Grey, and you know, this is how it would affect your life. That's really important to have that visual. That's the great side of the art side of this.
Without question, it just crafted the whole, to me, the concept of the optimal. You know, we live in a world now where we're interfacing on a minute-to-minute basis with everything, interfacing with cameras, with lights, with computers, with our phones, and Star Trek just took that to the idealistic level and did it so many years ahead of its time. And I just go back to that, you're interfacing and you didn't even realize it. Data would walk into the holodeck and things were happening, and now we're working towards virtual reality is going to be in our world 10 years from now. There'll be another talk just like this, and you'll be talking about VR and how Star Trek brought VR to the world. And it's going to be a
maybe
scene.
We'll be in VR.
Yeah, indeed.
Doing the panel.
You're creeping me out. No, but yeah, without question, that to me, when I'm designing the tricorder, I'm really trying to get to that point where it's a seamless experience for the user. Because when it's less intrusive, I think we've conquered one of the biggest obstacles in medicine. Why it makes it so challenging for us to provide care and for people to want to have care. It's because it's such an intrusive and invasive process.
And so, To pull out some of the themes of the clips we saw, in that first section, there's some scientific principles that are being described there, and two really interesting ones. I think there's the Big Bang, which I would imagine most audiences are familiar with, but something called the Dyson Sphere, which I'm sure is something that not many people have heard of before, or specific scientists are studying it, but those examples are the ways in which the writers of the show engage with scientific principles. How important do you think it is that Star Trek presents these principles to audiences, using scientific fact as its foundation to create science fiction? And I guess conversely, what are some of the challenges, do you think, or risks of working within those kind of scientific principles and presenting them in film and television?
We're always going to let you go first.
Great.
There's a pattern here.
That's awesome. I guess just because you mentioned it, the last part of the question, the challenges.
Sure.
Certainly making sure that the facts are accurate.
Right.
So when you're presenting a scientific world that you want to be believable and plausible, it is critical that information is accurate, as much as you can right. do that. Like, I think back to, a number of years ago seeing one of those crime scene shows, and they're doing something, and they grabbed a piece of rock, and they're like, oh, it's basalt, which, anyway, it's from a volcano. And they're like, oh, this must mean that this is from the bottom of the ocean, like something that was completely wrong. And it wasn't like, to me, it was just a pretty simple fact, but suddenly the whole show, I didn't find anything credible about it. And this was was meant to be a show based on scientific principle. And so Star Trek has that same kind of responsibility and that quality to it in respect for maintaining the accuracy of the science that they do present. And I think it's critically important.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think of a risk. I mean, I don't see, they don't jump out at me as, risk to us for delving into that. It just helps us imagine it again to see how it might be. And I never felt like everything I saw there was 100% true. I mean, when you talk about the Big Bang, it's a theory, and it's great to ponder that theory, but it's just a theory. I mean, it's a crazy theory. It boggles my mind when I think about it. And so I think that's just so fun that you have a show that's showing these things to the masses in a way that's entertainment. So people that would not normally be interested in reading, certainly wouldn't want to read it in a paper. I don't even want to read it in a paper. I'd love to see someone's visual of it, and that's fantastic. And because it's been so true to life and so believable, that's why it resonates with us. It's like The Martian, we were talking about it last night, and a lot of people asked me about it, and it's why I love that movie and love the book, is because for the most part, there weren't any real huge basalt moments. There was a couple small basalt errors, but I was still able to enjoy the film, despite those things.
I'm going to take this from a different point of view, just because what resonated with me when I watched the original Star Trek was, there's just so many sci-fi based shows out there and novels, but Star Trek took such a unique angle in that it mocked our current understanding of science. On a minute-to-minute basis, 20th century, it's like, you're sewing with catgut? Like, are you ridiculous? And I just did that literally 4 hours ago on a patient. And I'm like, you're right. What am I doing? I need to find another way. And they always challenged our notions of science, of what we consider dogma. And they did it in such a mocking way, and it was so clever. And I've never seen another sci-fi, any attempt at sci-fi, do it in a way that Star Trek did it.
So for a bit of behind the scenes on how they did do it, we invited Andre Bormanis to join us on this panel, who's a science consultant on The Next Generation and Voyager and Enterprise, also Deep Space Nine. And he unfortunately couldn't join us in person, but he did pass along a clip about his role as a science consultant on the show. So we're very grateful that he did. It's about 8 minutes long. So let's take a look at the clip from Andre.
So I became the science consultant for the Star Trek TV and movie series in the early 1990s, and my job was to help the writers and producers of the show with science and technical language and scripts, with the science ideas and their stories. They needed to make sure that all of our stories, all of the dialogue that the characters spoke, was grounded in ideas taken directly from science. And the reason that this is important on a show like Star Trek is because you want the audience to believe for the hour that they're watching that show that they really are on a starship out exploring the Milky Way galaxy. So if you play fast and loose with the definition of a star and a planet or the distances involved in traveling through space or how the ship works, or if 1 week you say, oh, the ship can travel 1,000 light years in an hour, but the next week you say, oh, it's going to take them weeks to travel 100 light years, the audience is going to pick up on that, and they're going to lose interest in the show, and they're just not going to believe it to the extent that you want them to. And so my job was to make sure that we had our facts straight to the extent that we were dealing with factual information. But of course, it's a show that takes place in the far future, and it involves technologies that don't exist, like warp drive and transporters. So we had to rationalize how those various kinds of future technologies worked by extrapolating from present day science and going off into the sort of the science fiction of what if. What if we could somehow master the kinds of energies and technologies needed to warp space? And would you be able to build a starship? And how might that look? How might it operate? So there's a lot of speculation in Star Trek, but it is based on real physics, real science, real astronomy, and that's what I think ultimately grounds the show in a sort of a sense of reality that makes it possible for viewers to enjoy the stories that the writers are developing. In season 4 of Star Trek Voyager, we did a story called Scientific Method. I got a call from one of our writers, Lisa Klink, and she was working on the script for this show. And the basic idea was that an alien race was basically using the crew of Starship Voyager as lab rats, but we didn't know it. The aliens were invisible. We couldn't see them. We didn't understand. We were being experimented on. It's a big mystery. And while that was happening, Lisa wanted the ship to stop and explore some interesting astronomical phenomenon that we hadn't seen on the show before. And so she called me and she said, hey, I'm doing this story and here's what it's about. And I want the crew to encounter something that we ideally haven't seen on Star Trek before, that's something kind of new and exciting in the world of real science that would be so amazing that Captain Janeway would stop the ship and want to check this thing out for some period of time. So I thought about it and I said, we've been discovering these things called binary pulsars. A pulsar is a dead star, it's a neutron star. Certain stars, when they exhaust all of their nuclear fuel, will collapse in on themselves, and all of the protons and electrons will get crushed into neutrons. And so a star that's maybe a million miles in diameter is condensed into a ball of neutrons that's only 10 or 12 miles in diameter. And because stars spin slowly, when they compress like this, they speed up like an ice skater who, you know, pulls in her arms as she's twirling and goes faster and faster. And so you get this amazing thing, this white hot ball of extraordinarily dense matter with very strong magnetic fields. And these magnetic fields create these sort of beacons of energy, matter from like the remnants of the star that falls back in on the neutron star, gets funneled by the magnetic fields into these two big towering fountains of plasma. And we've known these things existed for 40 or 50 years, but it was only recently, in terms of when this story was written, that we'd seen that sometimes they come in pairs and they orbit around the same point in space. And because of their density and because of the dynamics and because of Einstein's general theory of relativity, these things will inevitably collide and form a black hole. So if Captain Janeway and the starship Voyager chanced upon one of these things, some days before they were about to merge into a black hole, any scientist, of course, would want to watch that process and see how that happens. Watch it from a safe distance, of course. So that's what I pitched to Lisa. She loved it. She incorporated that into the script. Now, of course, we wanted to represent this as accurately as possible. So I got in touch with a scientist at Caltech, a man named Sri Kulkarni, who's an astrophysicist who specializes in these objects. And I called him and said, hey, we're doing this episode of Star Trek, and I would love it if you could provide me with some details about the orbital dynamics of neutron stars, how far apart they would be, how fast they would be spinning, how long it would take them to coalesce, what that might look like from a vantage point, you know, a few billion miles away. And so he was very helpful and generous with his time. I got him in touch with the art department, and based on what he explained to the art department, we created this beautiful visualization of a binary pulsar system.
Captain, one of the aliens has just entered the bridge.
Understood.
We're less than a million kilometers from the pulsars. We must change course immediately to avoid being caught in their gravity.
No, keep going.
This is a far more reckless course of action than I've come to expect from you, Captain.
It certainly is.
Hull stress is at 30 teradynes and rising.
I'm transferring more power to the structural integrity field, but I don't know how long it can hold.
What do you hope to accomplish by this?
Flying into a binary pulsar? Seems like I'm trying to crush this ship like a tin can.
It's more likely that you're trying to intimidate us.
You're welcome to stick around and find out.
Hull stress is at 45 teradynes.
Our course is locked in. Only my authorization can release it.
You're not behaving very rationally.
That's what you were trying to accomplish, wasn't it? Pumping up my dopamine levels to push me to the edge, keeping me awake for 4 days straight with the constant pain of your devices drilling into my skull. Well, this is the culmination of your work, and guess what? You're going to be right here to collect the final data.
Shields have failed. Structural integrity is down to 20%.
Enter the authorization code and change course immediately.
I don't think you realize that you are not in control here anymore.
I can kill you and your crew in an instant.
Go ahead. Without us, you won't be able to prevent this ship from being torn apart by the pulsars. And even with my crew working together, I'd say the odds of us getting through this are what? 1 in 10?
1 in 20, at best, Captain.
I'm willing to take that chance. Are you?
Outer hull temperature has reached 9,000 degrees.
The hull's beginning to buckle.
Two alien vessels are attempting to disengage from Voyager.
Break us free of the gravitational forces.
Then let's divert all power to the shields.
No, if we go in full throttle.
Captain?
Assuming we survive, we're gonna need all the momentum we can get to reach escape velocity on the other side. Everyone, hang on! I hope you were exaggerating about those odds, Tuvok.
I was not. All stress has exceeded maximum tolerance.
There are breaches on decks 4, 7, 8, and 12.
Emergency force fields are holding.
I've lost helm control.
Main power is offline.
Well, let's hope we've got enough speed.
So I think all kids are born naturally curious about the world. They want to know how things work, and I'm sure every parent has had the experience of hearing their child ask them question after question. Why is the sky blue? What makes a rainbow? Why does the moon change every night? And as we grow older, you know, school, work, other concerns start to creep in, and most of us, of course, don't grow up to be scientists. But I think everybody retains a certain amount of that childhood curiosity about the universe and how it works. And a show like Star Trek, it can get people, I think, inspired about science and show them the sort of the wonders that science has revealed about the universe and our place in it. Can't really stop to teach science, though. In the episode I was talking about with the binary pulsars, really couldn't stop the story to explain in any detail what a neutron star is, how general relativity works. But hopefully, if people find that episode fun and enjoyable and are intrigued by this strange astronomical thing that they've probably never heard of, maybe they'll go online and look it up. And, you know, obviously the visual arts are very helpful to scientists to express their ideas to the general public. And increasingly, we see this kind of partnership between science and filmmakers to better explain science, because it is so important to have at least a, you know, sort of a beginner's level understanding of science, because it affects our world in so many different ways. And there are so many choices that we have to make, ethical, moral decisions about the way science is used. And technology is progressing so rapidly these days, I think everybody really ought to have some basic fundamental level understanding of science and how science is done. So to the extent that a show like Star Trek can promote interest in science, get people excited about it again, get people curious about how it works, I think it does a real value to the scientific enterprise.
Thanks again to Andre Bormanis for that clip. You can tell he's an educator because he gives us a background on his role, a case study of an episode, and then summarizes his thoughts. An incredible contribution to the panel. So thank you again to him. It's exciting to hear about the process, the behind the scenes that Star Trek writers use to authenticate their storylines. Do you have any reaction to Andre's process? And do you think this is a helpful model for film and television? Can they and should they work with scientists and researchers to ensure that the storylines are complete? You'll start with Sunny down at the end there.
Yeah, there we go. Oh my God, you're throwing me for a loop. Yeah, without question, I think there's an obligation. I think, surprisingly, somewhat paradoxically, I feel like the farther we go away from Star Trek, the less responsible filmmakers are being. And so I think it's incumbent of us to sort of take those principles and adopt them. For example, me as a parent, when I'm making decisions about whether or not my children can watch a certain show, it's not like I have any control over that situation, but I pretend to have or the illusion of control exists. And, you know, my preference would be a show where there's some injection of authenticity and scientific reality and an educational component. And as Marianne alluded to, a lot of TV today doesn't really have that, even though it tries to. You know, from a medical perspective, there's a slew of very successful medical dramas on TV, and none of them are very realistic. And it's not hard to get that intelligence. There's doctors everywhere. It literally takes one phone call, and it's a testament to what Mr. Bormanis did, to actually call somebody with expertise in this. And it's shocking that it doesn't happen more often.
Yeah, I love that. That was really fascinating to listen to him explain how that came to be. And I have to admit, I've kind of taken it for granted how all of that credible information made its way into Star Trek. It's quite an accomplishment when you think about it. And I really believe that there is enough, intrigue in science fact to entertain us, that we don't need to go beyond science fact. In fact, you know, to explore some of the craziest theories that we have today would be really beneficial for people. I mean, I love it when young kids ask me about dark matter and dark energy, and because it's so easy to start to think that, hey, we understand this stuff. And the reality is there's more out there we don't understand. I mean, the more we learn, the more questions that we have unanswered, and the more we realize, well, we were really ignorant in our thought process. I mean, I grew up, I went through the education system. I cannot recall exactly when I made this realization, but it was well into education when I finally realized, oh, the answers aren't all in the textbook. I mean, I was under this illusion that we understood everything. And it's completely the opposite. We, in fact, the more we know, we really understand nothing. And I'm glad you brought up parenting because, you know, I'm always, you know, trying to walk that fine line of influencing my children to look at some of the fact out there. You know, they love to get lost in reading fiction, and that's great. And I love the fact that they consume a lot of fiction, but some nonfiction would be equally intriguing once they can find something they're interested in. And I'm always looking for that opportunity, you know, trying to slide it in subtly.
Yeah, I was also drawn in by that clip. I was waiting for the rest of the episode. I was like, oh, okay. There you go. But one thing, thinking about how this process, and one thing I really appreciate about Star Trek, it's not just the details of specific scientific fact, but it's the process of doing science and how that's integrated into the show. So, and we just take it for granted. They get to a new planet. They send out probes, they collect data, they go through the scientific process. It's part of what they do. And so emulating critical thinking throughout the show is a form of promoting science literacy. I mean, that's the part that I really appreciate about Star Trek. And whether, you know, some of these things are completely accurate or, you know, but that quality was done tremendously well.
And so moving that a little further, the example that Andre spoke about was a visualization of a scientific principle or theory. And I wonder if we can talk a little bit about the ethics of progress in science, because Star Trek, you know, explored the ethics of progress in a lot of ways, the ethics of time travel, medical advance, the prime directive and contact with pre-warp civilizations, and citizenship rights for androids, and a lot of the ways in which you know, progress can be good, but it also can be detrimental. And so, what effect do you think Star Trek has in advancing conversation about the ethics of science or the ethics of progress, and some of these kind of larger questions about what direction we should take, and is it valuable to having these conversations in such a public kind of setting?
I guess it's my turn to go first, isn't it? Yeah, it brings great value. And, you know, the answers, you know, I don't think the key to life is in Star Trek. I wouldn't go that far. But the fact that it makes you ponder, you know, what are the ethical choices that we will face as we become, as we interact, if we ever interact with other civilizations in our galaxy or beyond. And I think that's just, we need to ponder those things. We need to know that they're, you know, they're real issues. And then, but you can bring that back. You can think about it in the Star Trek term, but then you can bring it back to the real world, or our world, our present world, where we have all of these societies on this planet, and we know we should be working together, and we know we can accomplish more when we do work together, but we still have not mastered that. We still haven't figured that out. And so I think it's just important. It drives the thought process, makes people think about something they might not have thought about otherwise.
You know what, when I think about ethics in Star Trek, I also think about ethics of technology deployment, and it's so contextual because, you know, someone just died with a Tesla in autopilot mode. And so it got some press, but, you know, it starts to beg the question, literally behind the scenes in our lives, every decision we make when we're interfacing with something is based on an algorithm. And so who's vetting those algorithms? Who's auditing the algorithms? Who's got algorithms auditing the algorithms? You know, it turns out there's some press on this. Some of the algorithms we heavily rely on when we're doing Google searches are somewhat biased, and our impression is that they're not biased, but they're feeding us information to help influence our choices. And I love how science in Star Trek was always depicted in a manner where we have to maintain our ethics when we deploy technology, and really was really, really well done. And when I'm making those decisions now as a physician, testing my tricorder on patients in the hospital, the tricorder is approaching diagnosis and doing things in a way that's never been done. And I'll be very frank with you, I'm literally branded as a heretic in my own hospital. So much so that I don't have opportunities to do much research in my own hospital. And it's not a slight on them at all. It's literally they're maintaining their ethics and saying this is novel and very a different way of doing things. And we have to maintain our ethics and maintain patient safety when we deploy this technology. So I think it's a credit to my hospital. That not that I'm branded as a heretic, but that they're doing things safely. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just add a few comments about the importance of ethics and scientists together. Because I think often scientists, we can be seen as robots ourselves. We collect data, we interpret the data, there's facts. And we forget the context that we are humans conducting science. And Star Trek was very good about always presenting the context that we're humans doing these things. And the episodes and the storylines that I always really appreciated was when they really honed in on that fact. And so I really like Jean-Luc Picard as well. because it was those messy conversations of, do we do something? And it's usually coming from that ethical point of view. And in the scientific field, it's covered quite well in engineering. Ethics is a part of the engineering. Science, traditionally, not as much in terms of courses that you take. And that's something interesting to think about.
Sunny, you definitely want to talk about the tricorder in more depth. Just maybe one more question before we turn to advances and technological advances. Andre talked about, you know, individuals maybe after watching an episode going to learn more about science and the ways in which it encourages the public to learn more about our universe. What do you think the advantages are of having a scientifically literate or engaged society, and why is it important that we learn about our world and the universe?
Well, one thing that comes to mind, you know, we're kind of grappling with this whole idea of climate change and what is the ultimate outcome, and you know, are we going to step up and take true responsibility for this, and are we going to start creating a solution? And you know, if you're not educated in basic science, like Andre was saying, how do you make an informed decision? How do you filter the information you're getting from the media? Because you can basically pick whatever camp you want to be in and go seek that media, and your preference, the answer you're looking for is supported no matter what you do. And so you have to be in our society today, unfortunately, I think that's a shame, but you have to filter the information that you're being fed. And a lot of it is not accurate and not grounded in science. And so that's a really important skill set. And if media and art can start to give people that scientific process and a grounding in basic science, that's a wonderful education tool that will serve humanity.
Yeah, when I think of science literacy, and particularly a show like Star Trek and its promotion, you can come at it from the angle of promoting and enabling curiosity, for one thing. And then kind of what you were talking about as well. In terms of teaching the process of how to think. So learning the scientific process, thinking critically. And I think that's what we're getting to the heart of, is how do you think critically, and how do we value that? So, yeah, that's what I appreciate for sure about Star Trek.
We're breaking the paradigm. I'm not going to say anything about that question.
So I'll hit it back to you then. So in addition to inspiring the public, Star Trek has made huge impacts, I think, on the fields of science, technology, engineering, and the arts, encouraging people to create new technologies and pursue careers in science. And so, Sunny, you're such a direct result of this. You know, can you tell us about the vitality and your attempts to create the medical tricorder? Maybe the process and how you got involved, and where you're at with the competition?
Sure. Just briefly, I was volunteering in Haiti after the earthquake, and came across a patient in a in a volunteer hospital, and something as basic and fundamental as an ECG machine, which is like literally a pen and pencil as far as the hospital is concerned, and how it's important it is. They didn't. This hospital, which was the most modern hospital at the time in Haiti, because everything else had been destroyed, didn't have one. And luckily, I came across two engineering students who were volunteering, and we MacGyvered one, again, dating myself, with some guitar string, and we fixed a broken ECG machine, and we managed to identify the problem with her. We applied it to her, and we realized that, you know what, the world needs smartphone and intelligent and cheap, affordable solutions for medicine. That we can deploy in environments like that, or even for our First Nations people or our marginalized people in third world countries. And so the bridge that engineering and medicine, because I don't speak their language and they don't speak mine, when we started to pontificate, hey, how can we do this at another level, and the XPRIZE sort of gave us a springboard, an opportunity to consider this, Star Trek was the language we spoke in. The design language, so I could understand what they're doing, they understood what we're doing, and it literally, in many ways, the art and the media shaped our journey as engineers and as physicians pontificating this, and we paid homage to Star Trek in many ways with the design decisions we made. Mm-hmm. The tricorder that co-invented, has got three pieces to it, and that was deliberate. We wanted to pay homage to the original Star Trek, so it influenced us in so many ways.
And can you talk a little bit about the competition itself and the aims of that and how that is working in your process leading up to everything?
Sure. The funny thing is, maybe we won't tell that story. So I was thinking of telling the story about the inception of the Qualcomm tricorder XPRIZE. So Qualcomm, which is a major company in the United States in the mobile phone business, decided to sponsor this prize. If you don't know what the XPRIZE is, it's a nonprofit based in California. Peter Diamandis, who's also a founder of International Space University, came up with the concept after reading The Spirit of St. Louis, which is the journey of Charles Lindbergh crossing the ocean, and that rich hotelier in Paris said, the first person that crosses the ocean gets $50,000. And it was the incentive of that money that drove Lindbergh and his team to do this. And when he finished reading The Spirit of St. Louis, and it was given to him as a medical student because he was having problems finishing his flight school. He wanted to be a private pilot, Jeremy. And so his instructor said, read this. He actually read it and goes, you know what? This prize thing's interesting. And the story he tells is quite funny. Peter Diamandis' his biography, he tells it. But it turns out he said, you know what? The world needs another type of prize concept to fuel mankind to conquer some of these challenges like climate change that Jeremy spoke of. And so they find a big sponsor, injects a lot of money, and they created the Qualcomm Tricorder XPRIZE competition. It's a $50 million prize. And 3 years into the journey now, it started with about 330 companies and teams, academic teams. It's down to six, and we're the only Canadian entry left. And thank you. So we have a really talented team in Kitchener-Waterloo of engineers and a lot of people doing a lot of hard work on a sweat equity basis just because the concept resonates with them. What I realize is the XPRIZE helped us get there, helped bring engineers and like-minded individuals and Android developers and doctors together as a springboard. And now the greater vision is no longer the beauty contest that's the XPRIZE, which helped us galvanize us, but getting it to mankind. And one of the things we say in our office is to boldly go where no man has gone before. Somewhat ironically, our office is full of Trekkies, and we have we're flying the drone that you can buy from Toys R Us of the Enterprise, and it's pervasive in our mentality. Star Trek is really fueling us in so many ways.
It's such an exciting process, and hearing it's always wonderful to be reminded of Canada's strong contributions to technological advance and space exploration. Opening it up a little bit to Jeremy and Marianne is Star Trek in ways in which it inspired space exploration and travel. We don't have warp drive, but are there ways in which that Star Trek and how it portrayed how we could eventually explore space, has it inspired those working towards that goal?
Yeah, absolutely. So we do want the Enterprise, and we do want to be able to travel from this planet to other, at least easily around our solar system. But one of the things we've realized is the first thing we need to do is figure out how to exist in space, continuously. And that's one of the things that we intended to learn on the International Space Station. So now, this fall, we will have had humans continuously in space for 16 years. It's quite a remarkable achievement. And we've learned a ton and are continuing to learn a ton that you know will prepare us to allow or to exist outside the influence of Earth in our solar system. And that's a key step to living the dream of Star Trek, of exploring further, you know, eventually beyond our solar system. I think the other thing is that you have to imagine that you can do something before you go do it. And so now we've imagined things like traveling much faster than our chemical rockets of today will allow us to travel. And it's inspired people to look for new engine options for exploring our solar system. And there are some really neat ideas out there. And I mean, there's one right now that I know a gentleman who's doing amazing work and, in theory, could reduce the trip to Mars from 8 months to 40 days. And then, those benefits just get even greater as you go further into the solar system. And I mean, we're still a long ways from achieving that with that engine, but the fact that there's somebody who's successfully so far working on that dream, that vision, it's kind of like the impulse engines of Star Trek in my mind.
Yeah, it's interesting from also a technology point of view that medical tricorder is a perfect example. And I'm carrying that into other fields like geology. I mean, when Star Trek, when they're going to planets, they're taking out their scanners and they're instantly getting information. And this is what we're working towards when we're doing planetary science. So right now, really, we need to, the kind of holy grail is to bring samples back to Earth because we have sophisticated lab equipment here where we can get the detailed data. If we can miniaturize scientific equipment and send it to planets, for example, to Mars, we wouldn't necessarily need to bring something all the way back, which we haven't done yet, by the way. The only samples we have from Mars are meteorites that happen to fall on Earth. So this concept of miniaturization and automation and integrated approach, which Star Trek was visionary in seeing, is also something from a planetary science point of view is the holy grail. Yeah, and so likewise, there's kind of these technology advancements towards smaller instruments. There's what 10 years ago was large spectroscopy equipment or Raman. You can get a handheld thing that looks like a phaser and put it up against a rock to figure out the mineralogy of it. And these things are being tested now and, in fact, are being used in industry, in the mining industry, as a viable tool. And so we are approaching some of the technologies that we're envisioned in Star Trek, similar to on the medical side, on the geology side as well. It's great.
I gotta go back in
no,
here.
Please.
There's just too many things I'm thinking of. So you beam someone down to the surface of a planet, and you from the Enterprise, you can have communication with them anywhere. And now you can go anywhere on this planet and communicate. Anywhere on this planet and communicate with your loved ones back home. That's pretty incredible. I mean, space has enabled that. We use space all the time to scan this planet. There are so many sensors in orbit scanning this planet so that we can understand it. Radarsat is a really great contribution. It's a niche technology. Canada is a world leader in that. Radarsat looks through clouds. You can monitor our planet at any time, any weather. You can see right through it. You can get imagery on the forest fires that are affecting Fort Murray, flooding, monitor your borders, look for people that are evading our fishing laws and our fishing rights. I mean, just so many applications. Tracking air traffic around the globe, enabling that so we can fly safely. And with the number of airplanes in the sky, we couldn't do it without space in the future. And so it's just, there's so many of those things. The replicator, 3D printing in space. We have a 3D printer on the International Space Station. In the future, we will no longer need to bring everything. We will create a lot of the spare parts that we need. 3D printing with lunar regolith is an idea out there. So you go to the moon and you print your space station, or you go to Mars and you print your habitat. All these things. I mean, they were in Star Trek. They allowed us to see them. Sorry, I got excited.
No, it's a really great reminder, because we often think the gap between where we are and where the Enterprise is vast, but it's a great reminder that there are ways that gap is closing. We have progressed quite a lot from 1966.
We really just need the warp drive. I mean, if we can just get the warp drive.
It's the key piece, the key component. I want to go back to that opening clip, and we saw there's a wonderful montage of Data engaging with the arts, painting, music, performance. These scenes are quite poignant, of course, given Data is an android, but they emphasize the important relationships, I think, between science and the arts, that the arts can be a way of understanding, of problem solving. So I'm curious about, as scientists, as people working in science, what your approach is to the arts personally, and how do you think that they can enhance the work that you do in the sciences?
Wow, I have a lot to say about this. I guess I can come at it from two angles, and maybe I'll start pragmatically. So as a scientist, the arts, when we think of maybe visual arts, is vital in communication. Science communication is integral to our work, and it's mandatory. And whether that's communicating to ourselves, to other scientists, through publications, presentations, you eventually need to present your work. And that is going to involve the visualization of that work. And that is, there is that creative process of how you're going to do that that incorporates the art. So pragmatically, it's there, it's needed, that marriage happens. I think from another angle, maybe stepping back even farther, because when we think of science and the arts, we separate them somehow in our approaches. Science is this disciplined, step-by-step process, and the arts is, I'm being stereotyped here, I don't necessarily believe this, but arts is this kind of more amorphous, creative endeavor. And certainly we see examples of both of those approaches in each other's fields. I know a lot of artists who work in what we would see as a scientific way. It's trial and error. Have hypothesis, what will this color look like? What will this do? And you go through that process of testing and doing it. And from a science point of view, if you are coming up with new ideas, you need to infuse creativity into what you're doing. And how do you do that? How do you promote lateral thinking? And often you may need to go outside of your field. You need to talk to other people, incorporate a process that allows for that kind of creative or innovative of thinking to take place. So I strongly, you can tell, support and believe in an integrated approach to problem solving. And whether that's, some people think you're coming from a science point of view or an arts point of view, it's an integrated approach. And so you need all of it.
Yeah, I don't have anything that profound to add to it. Other than to say that raising three kids, I completely see the importance of having all aspects in their life. You know, they will find their passion, what resonates with them the most, and they will follow that passion. But there needs to be an aspect of all of those facets in their life. And I kind of feel like I didn't spend enough time in the arts, through education. I wasn't identified as an artist because I wasn't, I perceived myself as not a good artist. And so therefore, the natural inclination was to do the things that I was more inclined or more apt at. And it wasn't art. I could see it, I could set my art in art class beside my classmates. I could see, yeah, mine's worse. And I think that's a shame that we put them in categories like you're saying, because everybody, you need it. I still use it today. It's in there. I still fumble away at the piano a little bit, and I think that's a great asset, a great skill set to have.
I mean, I look at our tricorder that our team has built, and I think of it as a work of art. And I see people who have no scientific background at all injecting their vision into this tricorder, and to me it's a work of art, and it took people with creative minds bridging that gap of science and art, because unfortunately we dichotomize them in our society. I'm from the Jeremy School of Education, where I was pigeonholed as someone with a science aptitude, and so I'm woefully deficient in my ability to think like an artist, and it's hampered me. And thankfully I have people on my team who make up for that core deficiency and help me escape some of my preconceived notions when we were dreaming up new ways to diagnose a problem without using conventional means. And so I view our strike order is a work of art in that respect. And in speaking to Marion's terms, and when we're communicating scientific terms and we're propagating ideas and generating dialogue, the TED Talks are a perfect example of the merger of science and art, and they've done it incredibly well. They've taken scientific concepts that are so difficult to grasp and boring in some ways and made them so engaging and created dialogue. You know, a YouTube video from a TEDx talk generates millions of hits now. I find that we're finally in a place now where we no longer need to dichotomize them.
And Marion, can you describe STEAM for us then, and how, as co-founder of STEAM Labs, what some of the initiatives under the STEAM kind of rubric to bridge science and the arts, and what are some of the goals of STEAM education?
Sure. So STEAM is an acronym that's I think more commonly being used in formal education circles. So it's a riff off of STEM. So STEAM is science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. So it inserts the arts in that STEM concept in the recognition of this kind of interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary approach. And so when we talk about formal education, we certainly, probably most people in this room, have come through an education system that is siloed in how we approach our topics. You have a math class, you have a technology class, you have an arts class, and they're separate from each other. And the concept of STEAM is to have this integrated approach. And so the nonprofit you're referring to, STEAM Labs, it's a makerspace, which is essentially a workshop where adults and kids can go to and build things. And the approach there, and we have STEAM in the title, which some people will get, some people won't, but the philosophy of this kind of approach is you're coming at it from a problem-solving point of view that's interest-driven by the participants. So whether this participant is a kid or an adult, they're coming with ideas of something they want to do. Maybe it's for fun, maybe it's a problem they want to solve, but they're not limited in how they're going to tackle that problem. Maybe they need a little bit of science, maybe they need some math. They're also, you know, probably going to need some arts, and they're using everything at their disposal to attack that problem. And so it's just kind of flipping that approach from starting from this topic-based, skill-based, to stepping back and going from the problem and figuring out what do you need to do to tackle it, and then to use everything at your disposal.
We're going to turn to your questions in a minute, so feel free to start thinking of them. Maybe just one question to lead us into the audience Q&A. Returning back to the quotation from Captain Kirk at the end of that reel, he says, I'm quoting here, important to seek knowledge, understanding, to embrace risk. Why is it important to you to embrace risk and seek understanding and knowledge? The risk part is interesting. You know, it really is about putting ourselves out there and going beyond what might be possible. So can you talk a little bit about risk and what risks there are maybe in the initiatives that you're doing and why it's important to still undertake them?
Sure. I'm happy to start. I have a strong association of risk with the concept of failing. When we're talking about concepts like STEAM, maker education, inquiry-based education, there's an embracement of failure and failing because this is a mechanism for learning and it's valued. And it promotes, I guess you could say, that ability and appetite for taking risk, because it's okay. It's okay to fail. And recognizing that as a tool to move past that, you know, failing and to adapt and to come up with a new idea and go forward with it. So the embracement of the concept of risk is also embracing the concept of being okay with failure and seeing it as a positive mechanism for learning.
Two thoughts on that. In the astronaut corps, where you really we're really embracing this culture of, being completely open and honest about your skill sets and places where you need help. And, you know, we have this huge team that allows space exploration to happen for us. It's enormous. You know, there are right now there's 3 astronauts in the space station. Next week we'll be back up to 6. But the team that actually enables that is enormous. And we have to rely on one another being completely open and honest about where, you know, my knowledge ends and where I need, you know, Marianne to step in and pick up the pieces or show us the answer or the way. And that's really important that we don't view ourselves as perfect or know-it-all. We view ourselves as humans with a limited skill set. And then in my job, of course, you know, that it's we have that element of risk to, you know, our lives, of course. And I shared this last night, but I think it's really interesting perspective. I've met a number of the Apollo astronauts, and I ask each one of them the same question, essentially that, you know, how did you do what you did in 10 years? I mean, really, they went from zero to going to the moon and coming back in 10 years, and it seems like we're not able to even replicate what they did today with our improved technology. And they all give essentially the same answer, which I found really interesting, and it was that we were going. I mean, that was very clear to us. We signed up, and we were going to the moon. And it was just a matter of how safe we could make it in the amount of time and money that we had. And I think that is a really important thing to remember. You know, we're in a risky business of flying humans to space, to explore space. It is very risky, and we know that. But we have to realize we made a decision to do this. We're going to do it. We're going to accept the risk. And then we're going to work as a team within the resources available to make it as safe as we possibly can. So we're in the business of managing risk to the best of our ability, knowing that we won't reduce it to zero.
Well, I wish I'd seen Captain Kirk's clip when we were making decisions about the X Prize and showing investors that, you know, that there's a risk here. So risk means two things to me. I'm going to borrow from Jeremy when he talks about two points, and one of them actually involves Jeremy. He doesn't even realize it. So when I was at Canadian Space Agency, astronaut recruit and eventually a reject, thank God for Canada, I probably would have crashed the space station if I was up there. But at one point, and you know, taking risks took fundamentally a new meaning to me. I was a boy who never learned how to swim for lots of different reasons. My mother had my hand read when I was in India, and a pundit had told her that I will die by water. And she literally took that as, this boy should not go anywhere near water. From a medical perspective, it probably meant heart failure, pulmonary edema, or fluid building up in my lungs, which is how most of us die. But so he was actually right in a weird way. So here I am at the Canadian Space Agency astronaut recruitment. I got to the final 39. Jeremy's actually beside me. I don't know if you remember this. So one of the things we had to do was jump in this military pool at Saint-Jean, Quebec. Remember this, Jerry?
Yeah, I remember.
And so we're beside each other, and there's a third guy beside Jeremy who's actually, funny enough, happened to be, he told me as we're getting up, lining up, I don't even think I've worn swim trunks before. And and they're like, you have to swim this pool, this 50-meter pool, and it's really deep, 5 times. I don't know how to swim. And I'm terrified of the water. But I'm like, you know what? I got to take the risk. This is it. So I jumped in the water, and I doggy paddled for 2 laps before I finally could not keep it up, and I had to get out of the water. And Jeremy got, so another guy got out of the water really fast. Turns out he's an ultra Ironman, and books have been written about his fitness ability. He's an amazing Canadian, and you know, it's a testament to this guy. And then Jeremy got out of the pool, and Jeremy stands beside me and goes, Sonny, how did you do that so fast? And I'm like, dude, I didn't finish it. I couldn't breathe. So speaking of risk, you have to take risks. And so the two most profound moments in my life were going through the CSA astronaut recruitment. I failed. And yet it was probably the most wonderful learning moment for me. And now the tricorder, we fully expect to fail because there's a lot of components to our tricorder that need work, and we're not going to meet the timelines for the X Prize. But just like the Apollo astronauts, we're not stopping. And we fully anticipate failure, and we're going to embrace that failure moment, and we're going to learn from it, and we're going to celebrate the failure. And I hope that day comes, because I have a lot of designs about how that failure moment's going to look like, because we're going to take it. It's going to hurt. It's definitely going to hurt, but you can embrace the moment. And so risk and failure, to me, Marianne, you said it so well. They're intimately intertwined to me.
That's all incredible advice. Let's turn it to you. We have microphones ready. Just place your hand up and we'll get a microphone to you. Let's go over here first.
So I have 2 questions. One of the things I find interesting is that none of you have been reflecting on the contradiction opposition between story and science. One of the things I find so interesting looking, Jeremy, at what people do in space at the space station is how, in relationship to Star Trek, how fundamentally boring it is. It's maintenance work. It's being a lab technician. It's et cetera, et cetera. What you have in Star Trek is the casting of space in this incredible narrative context in which we are encountering true otherness, and in so doing, we are understanding ourselves. Do you think, first question, that it as a narrative makes people look at what we are actually doing in space and just be fundamentally disappointed by everything? Because nothing is as good as Star Trek. The second question is, if you're looking for the paradigm in which your children are looking at the future, I would suggest to you that it's not Star Trek, but it is this massive amount of dystopias which now appear on television in movies all over the place, where it's a presentation that says to these people, the future is going to be worse than the present. Be prepared for things getting worse. Be prepared for some bad ending to the world. How does that relate to, in your mind, to Star Trek?
Yeah, so let me try to tackle that first one. We know that the space that we typically portray is very boring to watch. I mean, if you watch Canada Arm Operations, you know, we stream those for people. It's really boring. Like, it's really slow. And when we create a clip of Canada Arm doing anything, we have to like do it at 10 times speed just so that people will actually watch it, hopefully through the completion. And we're very aware of it. You know, it's interesting. I thought about it at the end of one of my previous answers was, you know, with respect to artists, one of the reasons Chris Hadfield's outreach was so successful because, you know, Chris and the Canadian Space Agency really embraced the idea of portraying what he was doing in an artistic format. You know, of course, there was the music side of it, but beyond that, there was people could actually live and see what it is and see his enthusiasm with what he was doing. And yeah, you know, day to day, if we made you watch all of it, it would be boring. But if we show you some of the clips, some of the things that excite us in space, it's not boring. You know, if I would argue with you that if I could put some imagery of the Earth from space, you wouldn't say it's boring. And I definitely know 100% sure, based on all the feedback that I've gotten, that if I could take you to space and you and I could float in the cupola, the windows of the space station, and look back on the planet, you would find it more fascinating than Star Trek. And it's really just our challenge to, it's something maybe because we didn't have enough steam in our lives that we're not naturally good at. You brought it up. You know, at some point as a scientist, you have to present your ideas. And we're not naturally, a lot of us aren't naturally good at presenting the ideas. We get really focused in on what we're doing. And I think there's a lot of room to do that. But it goes back to what I was saying. I think science fact could be as interesting as the science fiction, could be as interesting as Star Trek. We just need to keep working on how we portray it and display it for people. I'll let someone else tackle the...
Concept of the story and the paradox is a very tangible one to me, because, you know, when you're approaching all sorts of stakeholders who are interested in the tricorder, their vision is that portrayed by Star Trek, and they're invariably disappointed when they see what we built, which is, to me, 22nd century concepts, but it's still disappointing because it's not Dr. McCoy's little magic wand. And so it resonates with me on a daily basis. And so how do I portray what we've done to those that don't understand and are not sophisticated in this particular sphere of the world and what we're doing, that it is actually something that to celebrate and it is innovation, and not the dystopian reality? Well, that's your second question. Yeah, I'm a zombie movie fan, though, so I shouldn't answer the second question.
I guess just to tackle the second question or comment, it's interesting. You know, 50 years from now, if we're sitting at this panel, what would we be talking about? You know, if we're not talking about Star Trek, what today in the media is something that will kind of last the test of time? And, you know, arguably, I think you're right. A lot of what's out there right now has this kind of negative view. And I think the reason Star Trek has had this lasting effect is this positive view. And maybe just throwing that back out there as a challenge to people who are involved in the arts and media to embrace that. I mean, there must be a reason why there's so many of these kind of dystopia kind of products coming out and their popularity. But we can see through the franchise of Star Trek that having this positive look can also be popular. So I would just throw it back out there as a challenge.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned it. It's worth giving some thought to, and just I hadn't thought about it before, so this is off the cuff. But I would say, you know, too much of that negative thinking is not good for us, and we're a lot better off when we think positive, when we put positive energy into a situation, and we imagine a positive future. And I think the reality of humanity is that we will always, you know, have these ups and downs, and but every time we truly, when we get to the breaking point and we realize, wow, it's do or die right now, we will do. We always have, and I'm that optimistic that I don't believe in those negative outlooks of the future. I really believe in a society that continues to get better. It's not like a constant climb because there's a little bit up and down, but we will continuously get better, and I'd honestly believe that the world will be a better place in the future.
Over here? I'd agree with the panel that the show created a scientific curiosity. I'd challenge your premise that there's a whole bunch of science in that show. You mentioned the example of the basalt rock, and you mentioned the medical people who weren't giving you phone calls. I expect the script writers on Star Trek are no more rigorous about their scientific checks that they do. In fact, in Next Generation, I think there was part of the plot in the scripts that have a little bit where it says, insert gobbledygook here, and they had a name for it. And, you know, the show is all about creating drama. And often, to create drama, you had to have the ship behave a certain way, which probably defied some rules of science. The classic one, of course, we all know is explosions in space, and you know that fireballs and sounds and vibrations don't happen. I'm okay to suspend my disbelief in some of those aspects. Time travel, faster than light travel, the transporter. I'm okay, but the science probably took a second seat to the drama of the show.
Anyone want to respond to that, or is there another question out there? Oh, actually, right beside. Yep, go ahead.
Hi. So one of my favorite, this is not related at all, sorry. One of my favorite recurring moments in the original series is that Spock can't beat Kirk at chess, even though Spock has complete mastery of the scientific method. And the whole conceit is that Kirk has a better understanding of human nature, and that's why he always wins at chess. And so I'm kind of curious as to, I feel like human nature in Star Trek is better than human nature is now. People are more noble, society is more progressive. And I think technology and, you know, how progressive society is, that needs to happen together. So I'm wondering what you think that we need to do as a society to make room for this technological innovation.
Co-founder of Steam Labs.
I guess I'm trying to unpack everything that's in there, because there's the comment about humanity, and then there's this link to innovation, and I think I'm just trying to get my head around the angle or the question.
Technological innovation, when you don't have a more progressive human nature, I'm just thinking of, for example, gunpowder being used for violence as opposed to fireworks, which is what it was originally developed for. How can we move in a progressive direction, nonviolent direction? And what do we need to do to accomplish that?
Yeah, so I actually think the XPRIZE mechanism is a great example of that, where there's this prize for doing something that's incredibly positive. Programs like some of our co-founder Singularity University that challenges people to make a difference to a billion people on Earth. Like, these kinds of positive challenges are driving positive innovation. And I think with the onset of on the space sector, new space, or just philanthropy and companies and billionaires kind of getting involved in these efforts is raising that visibility. So I'm encouraged by that. And I think that's welcomed and needed, just so that it can maintain that profile in the public's eye.
So it finally came to me, I think, what I think is really necessary for us, and we're already on our way there, it's the communication system of our planet. So we now can communicate around the globe. And I have a little, I have a theory, just a pet theory in my head that, you know, we're destined for improvement because, you know, if you went back 50 years ago, you might be able to convince me that somebody, you know, some society around the world was evil. But you can't convince me of that anymore because I can travel around the world and there are too many, all of my examples and interactions are that people are just people around the world. You can no longer trick me and I can speak with them and I can communicate anywhere in the world. So that is such a huge improvement for humanity. And so what do we need? We need to take our communication system to the next level. So now that we can communicate, it's a mess. The internet's awesome, but it's messy. And we have all this, I talked about earlier, this misinformation with the information in there. And so the next step in my mind, the next vision is the ability to prioritize problems, identify problems, prioritize problems on a global scale, and then identify solutions that are vetted and ranked some way and prioritize those solutions. And that is the next evolution for us, for managing, you know, all the things you're talking about, how we utilize scientific breakthroughs and we ensure that they don't become major problems for us. But I mean, good luck with that. That's not trivial.
I mean, XPRIZE is one of its foundational principles is you know, embracing technology in a way that benefits humanity. So here's an example. At the Visioneering Summit for the XPRIZE, we're coming up with new prize concepts, and they bring all these people together with varying backgrounds, a lot of people from the arts world were there, which I really found fascinating. But there's a new prize concept being developed. It's called the Limitless Avatar XPRIZE, and a Japanese airline, their most successful airline, their CEO resonated with this and is injecting millions of dollars into this XPRIZE. And the concept is creating an avatar of yourself, a full likeness of yourself that you're controlling, you're manipulating, to allow you to put yourself in an environment that you would never otherwise be in. So the example that resonated with me is now I'm as a doctor, here I am, and now I'm in a village in Ethiopia in the middle of an Ebola outbreak, and I can actually manipulate my avatar and do things and get things and educate people and teach and learn and interact with a society I normally is very foreign to me. And if we use technology like an avatar, and we can break down some of those communication barriers and you know, lead to a higher level of understanding for humanity. And maybe when we understand each other better, we'll break down some of those barriers and it'll lead to more happiness.
Over to this side here. There's a microphone. Yeah.
I have three students who are going to ask questions, but before they do, can we take pictures of them asking questions for our blog post?
Yes, go ahead, as long as everything happens quickly.
Okay, he'll do it very quietly. And to the gentleman, it's called Techno Babble.
Hello? Oh, okay, it works. I was going to ask, if you're about to fly into space, are you scared? Or are you just thinking that if I fail, it's kind of just game over?
So, you know, I haven't flown to space, so I haven't had that experience. But I've been in, you know, lots of high pressure scenarios, you know, flying fighter jets where it was very clear to me that, you know, I've been in situations where I was like, I may not survive this. And so, and I have a very good sense of how I react in those situations now. And it, for me, emotion is separated for a period of time. In some of the most intense scenarios I've been in, I don't remember feeling any emotion. I set it aside completely. I completed the checklist that I was supposed to complete. Luckily for me, everything worked out well. And then after I was all over, you know, I actually was like uncontrollably shaking. You know, I don't know what happened in my body. Sunny can probably tell me, but there was some involuntary response going on there. Whatever chemicals had been released to get me through that situation were now, you know, causing me to involuntarily shake. And that's when, you know, I allowed the emotion to come back in and dealt with that. So I have contemplated what it'll be like to launch to space. And I mentioned this last night, but it is the day of the launch. I don't expect to be very nervous. and to be very focused and in the rocket ship, you know, just to complete my tasks. But the day before, I expect to be very pensive, and I expect there to be some mixed emotions about, you know, the risk that I've accepted already and, you know, saying goodbye to my family. I expect that to be a very emotional time. But you make these decisions beforehand, and then once you've done that, you're like, okay, let's get on with it.
Hi, my name is Javier. I just had one question. So I have a friend named Chris, and he knew I was coming here today, and he got really interested into the Steam Labs thing, a company, sorry, and he was wondering if there's anywhere he can find out more information on Steam Labs.
Sure, yeah. So Steam Labs is actually it's a not-for-profit organization. It's very close. It's around the corner. And you can go online. It's steamlabs.ca, the website, if anyone wants to look up more information about it.
Okay, thank you.
Can you and so what kind of programs, initiatives do you offer to young people, adults? And
yeah, so Steam Labs is unique in that there are a number of actually makerspaces across Toronto, across the country, across the world. Steam Labs is unique in that it's all ages. And so there's programs that are dedicated to youth as well as programs dedicated to adults. And it also caters to a range of abilities, skill sets. It really embraces the concept of diversity as well. So people can come in who may consider themselves to be novice in some way, and there's an entry point, as well as there's actually members, adults can join and kind of have a monthly membership, who are creating their livelihood. So they might be creating a product that they're selling on Etsy or something like that. And so there's an entrepreneurship angle that can be supported through these kinds of places as well.
There's another question in that group there. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi. I was just wondering, since all these amazing new inventions and new technologies have such great potential for positive impacts to society and just people in general, but they can also have such horrible impacts, how do you think we could control the direction they go into and in a, I guess, respectful way, and keep it and keep innovation coming towards positive results and not misuse?
You. you are the generation. You are the ones that are immersed in this dystopic view of the future, and you're going to be the problem solvers. And when we embrace these concepts of STEAM and all of these kinds of concepts, it's around problem solving. And what I didn't mention earlier is what's integral in that philosophy is empowering. Empowering people to be able to make a difference. And so when we talk about technology, any technology, anything, how many people really understand it? When you buy something from the store, how many people can open it up and, you know, your phone breaks, can you fix it? And increasingly we're in a society where really we're quite disconnected in some ways from understanding our technology. And so if we can change that mindset to one being like, hey, I'm going to actually get inside there and learn a bit more about how these things work so that I can change that. I don't have to sit back and be a consumer of whatever comes my way. I can be the change that I want to see, and I can be empowered to do that. And if there's one message I can leave for around education, I've been thinking about this a lot lately, you can think about our education in the same way. Do you want to sit back and accept what is given to you? There's a lot of great value to what happens. Maybe there's something missing that you want to know more about. Don't feel limited in what you want to learn. Empower yourself. We didn't get to it, but like my career path, I academic, geologist. The reason I'm in the role I'm in now is also because all the things I did outside of my academic path. And I needed those two things together to do what I'm doing now. So create the opportunities that you want to see. Don't sit back and think someone's going to necessarily provide it for you. Empower yourself. And I love organizations like Steam Labs and other spaces that are doing that, are empowering people to do that.
Hello.
my question is, in Star Trek, they had a lot of funky, I guess, outfits and different technologies that they used in fashion to allow them to go on different planets and to be able to sustain, I guess, when they were on different planets because they got abandoned for some reason. So do you guys know of any different new technologies that are going on that help medically or even in space to allow humans to, I guess, explore more in those areas?
So, and you said medically, specifically?
Just for space and medically as well. Like.
Mm-hmm. So Canada, for the Canadian Space Agency, we focus quite a bit on medical research that can be done in space. It's one of the areas we've identified as bringing a lot of value back to Canada. So we encourage science in that area, research in that area. And there are a number of things. You know, one that's very easy to visualize is the fact that we created Canadarm technology to do space robotics. But when you want to have a space robot, you have to have very precise control. It's a very complicated engineering problem. It's not just about physically building an arm and, you know, having some sort of electrical motor that moves it. It goes much beyond that in the software, because you can't have an arm that could possibly suddenly swing and put a hole in your space station and everybody dies. And you have to be very, very, very precise, very, very in control of that arm. And the technology, the software technology and the force feedback and all these things that we created for Canadarm are now used in robotic surgery. And so we have three robotic surgery robots in Canada right now that have come directly from the technology of Canadarm. I'll give you an example, IGAR. I think it's a really neat one where, you know, the present day technology is to, if you have a lump in a breast and you need to do a biopsy, you put the patient in the scanner, you create the map of where the lump is you want to biopsy, and then you go in, you pull them out of the scanner, and then you take the biopsy based on the map you created, and you're hopeful, and there's a very high percentage of there's a very high rate of success of getting the tumor area, but you never know for sure. And so now you can build a robot that goes inside the imaging machine. You make it out of a non-metallic material, and you can take the biopsy in real time while you're imaging and ensure you get the right spot. So that's kind of a neat technology that's transferred. Another one is that we've been working on Space Station, kind of along the lines of the tricorder, is analyzing blood in space. Currently what we do is we take blood samples all the time on Space Station, unfortunately, for astronauts. But we freeze the blood and then we return it to Earth. And the same thing happens in some remote regions in Canada. You can take the blood sample, but you can't analyze it. The labs don't exist in that area. And so we're actually building a small unit that works in space to analyze blood. We've been working on that research, and it'll have a direct implication here on Earth. Those are a couple examples.
We have time for two more questions. I think there's two more microphones out there, so these would be the last two questions. Let's go to this side first.
Hi, so one of the big things about Star Trek is the Federation, where not only different countries, but different planets join together for one common goal of space exploration. So do you think that's one of the ultimate goals of the scientific community, is to be able to share information and resources with the only limitation being our minds? And do you think we would be able to go further faster if that happened?
I can speak to that just from a medical perspective. So there's all these companies creating technologies, and of course the primary objective is to treat patients, but a secondary, almost equal objective is to generate value for the investors and generate money. So it's for profit in many ways. And so as a result, for companies, for example, trying to find a cure for a treatment for breast cancer, let's say, they have competing interests in some way and they don't share data. And so, you know, we have this platform, and if we don't share the data, we don't really progress as a society. And so, yet the system is set up to not allow ourselves to share data. So we're starting to break down some of those paradigms. And there's some forward-thinking people that are saying, you know what, society needs open access to data, not just from a medical perspective, but across the planet and all the different realms, whether it's geological or meteorological or medical data. And I think this revolution of miniaturizing technologies, whether it's geological or medical, and bringing them to the home, allows the person who generated the data to now own that data. And so we call it the democratization of data. And I think when we get to that place where we're sharing and openly and honestly creating dialogue, because nobody owns it anymore, we can break down some of those barriers. I think I'm addressing your question. It's trying to unpack it.
Yeah, I, I'll just jump in here too, because I guess my answer is yes. I consider myself maybe an idealist or an optimist in that striving to achieve that open data concept across disciplines is something that we're working towards. And some fields are doing it more successfully than others. So there are, for example, genetic data sets that are online and open to everyone that allow these data repositories that allow researchers from across the world to put in genomic information, and anyone can go in and do the comparative work. That model, I think, will increasingly transcend other fields as well. I think some other fields, and it's not just industry where you see this competitiveness, it happens with academia as well, because the currency there is publishing papers. And the fear is being scooped and not being able to publish your paper. And so breaking down those boundaries is a challenge. But something to work towards is this open data concept where it is truly available for everyone. Because that's a resource. And really, fundamentally, we're as taxpayers, are supporting this work.
Yeah. And so it's diametrically opposed to that dystopic society that I'm still thinking about that man's question, because it's so profound. I think it's a panel for discussion for another day. But yeah, it's diametrically opposed to that, because that's a very utopian concept, sharing our data where resources aren't scarce. And if they are, we're sharing them and pulling them together so everybody benefits.
I also add that the conversation does continue tonight. We have a panel this evening on space diplomacy and the United Federation of Planets. So we will continue to have this discussion about diplomacy and how countries can work together. Last question with a microphone there. Yeah, in the center.
It sort of follows up on the last question. Ephraim Cochran made first contact in 2063. That's just a couple years from now. But when you go back into the mythos of Star Trek, he was a drunk, he was a failure at life. And yet he's the one who essentially gave us the Federation, who gave us everything. He met the Vulcans because he went and did something everyone told him wasn't possible. Do you think that the future of science and big breakthroughs like this are more in people like the Bitmaker Labs or more in government agencies like CSA?
That's a good question. Yeah, no, there's no answer to that. I mean, more what I share with our young Canadians is that everybody has a contribution to make. And it's become very clear to me. You know, I'm not telling you something you don't know, but you just have to think about this once in a while. The reason I get to work in the space program and go to space is because we as a society have figured out clever ways to produce food and have, you know, a high standard of living. You know, I don't have to spend my time surviving. Survival is made very easy for me, which gives me the bandwidth to be an explorer, because I rely on farmers and an infrastructure, and you know, because everybody is involved in making what I do possible, and everyone has a contribution to make. And I kind of want to tie these two together now. In, you know, International Space Station, you know, it is a really important symbol. It's the most unappreciated aspect of the space station is the fact that, yeah, we did this we accomplished this incredible technological feat. It is amazing. It's taken for granted. People don't understand how hard it is what we're doing on the space station. It's not fun and exciting to watch a lot of what we're doing, but boy, is it a challenge. It is a huge challenge. Such a huge challenge that we attracted minds from around the globe. You know, right now the partnership is five agencies, if you will. So, you know, Canada, United States, Russia, Japan, and then the European Space Agency, which represents many, many countries. What the European Space Agency does is pretty remarkable. The fact they bring all those countries together under one space agency and come forward with a plan that works for all of them. And that is not trivial. And you don't want to sit through those meetings, because it is a huge undertaking. And I'm sure we'll talk about some of that tonight. But that is the whole point. And so for every individual that I speak to, for every young Canadian I speak to, you have to set goals in your life and surround yourself with a team that will allow you to accomplish those goals. And that is what we do in the space program. That's what the Canadian Space Agency is. For me, it sets huge goals on behalf of Canada, which brings together great people that would have done awesome things on their own, but because they have a team, like you have a team, because we created this team, they accomplished the impossible. And that is ultimately, I think, how we'll do it. There may be those one-off where somebody has this one an amazing discovery in a silo, but in general, our progress will be enabled through cooperation.
Do you want to, final notes to build on what Jeremy just said?
Yeah, to kind of build off of that, because I think there was another element to that question about the framework that's in place for this to happen. Is it strictly through a government, or can regular people be involved? And that's one thing I'm incredibly encouraged about. When we talk about open data, when we talk about maker communities or STEAM, it's allowing everyone to be involved. And so when we think to the future discoveries, where will they come from? If we can create communities that connect people across governments, across the general public, across all these different areas, we're only going to get better ideas. If we're not limited to our kind of existing silos. And I think that is the direction we're going. I think that kind of democratizing of ideas and innovation in science, that's what I'm seeing. That's the trend I'm seeing.
Thank you all for your wonderful questions. That was really great. I will remind you, yes, the conversation continues tonight on diplomacy. We welcome Lawrence Krauss here for a talk on Star Trek and science on November 2nd. And we're very pleased to also have educator and former NASA astronaut Mae Jemison here on December 5th to speak about representation and social utopia in Star Trek. To conclude today's panel, we will be running a clip from CBS to tell you all about the numerous fantastic ways that you can watch Star Trek in the comfort of your own home. But before we do that, that'll happen as you file out. Please join me in giving a huge thank you to our panelists, Mary Mader, Jeremy Hansen, and Sunny Coley.
I think we should give Keith a hand too. It's literally remarkable, your acumen, and I think you present this panel very, very well. So hand to Keith.
And we can roll the Star Trek clip.
Space.
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 The final frontier.
These are the voyages of the starship Enterprise.
Enterprise.
Enterprise. Her ongoing mission, to explore strange new worlds.
To seek out new life and new civilizations.
To boldly go.
To boldly go.
To boldly go.
Where no man has gone before.
Celebrate 50 years of Star Trek.
Cheers.
With the limited edition gift set, get 30 Blu-ray discs featuring the original show and movies with the original crew, plus the animated series for the first time on Blu-ray, along with a 2-hour multi-part documentary. And available in this gift set, get a 50th anniversary badge, 6 mini movie posters, and hours of special features.
Is that all you gotta say?
And experience the Wrath of Khan director's cut.
Fire!
On Blu-ray for the first time ever, including nearly 30 minutes of new bonus content.
I would not presume to debate you.
That is wise.
And for the first time in new ultra-slim Blu-ray sets, Star Trek, the complete original series, and the Next Generation complete series.
Sophisticated technology.
Resistance is futile.
Surrender and prepare to be boarded.
That will be the day.
Fire!
Add to your Star Trek collection.
Let's make sure history never forgets the name Enterprise.
Available on Blu-ray today. And look for Star Trek and Star Trek Into Darkness. Available for the first time in stunning 4K Ultra HD. Plus, don't miss Star Trek Beyond, coming soon on Blu-ray and digital HD.